Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Hearthstone Singapore Major. My name is TJ. This is Lothar. And Lothar, it's the last match of the day, so you know what that means?
Yeah, it means that we'll end the day after this match.
It also means it's time to roleplay.
Okay, click on me.
Boop. Beep. Boop.
Well met.
Well met.
I'm a new skin, so I don't have one emote yet.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Only one emote. Lothar skin, I would buy that skin in a heartbeat.
$10.
There you go.
Now it looks good.
Well, it's been a fun day of matches so far. We've been through 7, actually. And a lot of matches have happened off stream. So, over the course of today, the Hearthstone Singapore Major has eliminated a lot of players and moved a lot of players on to the next day. And now we're going to see Korn Echo, the Japanese player, taking on TCG.
It's quite
from
funny.
Vietnam.
He is named TCG, but he plays as CCG.
Yeah. Maybe once upon a time you played some TCGs, but the name might mean something different because the C is...
Is small? You think that's...
It's lowercase.
Relevant?
Maybe. I think his name was longer. He just shortened it to TCG.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Makes sense.
But another rogue. So that's going to be, what, 4 or 5 rogues that we featured on stream?
That's cool. I really like to see how people are playing rogues.
Yeah.
And seems like the warriors are banned. Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah. It's interesting, but a lot of players just don't like to play against warrior. I think warrior and druid have been the most common bans today just because of that.
Well, druid does nothing new when it comes to bans.
That's true.
It was a ban magnet for a long time. And probably will still be, even after Standard.
Yeah, even in Last Hero Standing, Druid was banned a lot of time. Because it was the deck that, you know, you just throw it out the beginning. And sometimes, even if you just picked up 2 wins.
It's still enough.
Yeah, it was still enough. It would give you that advantage. So even so far back as, you know, 2014.
Well, do you remember the King of the Hill with Arthosis? That was, you know, made like beginning of 2015, I think. And King of the Hill was won by Ties 11 times in a row. And he was like sweeping everyone with Druid.
Yeah, I remember that.
Okay, so we're starting the match.
We're starting off the last series of the day with Freeze Mage versus Freeze Mage. Indeed.
Well, that will take a while.
We dodged it all day long, Lothar, but we can dodge it no longer.
And both players have Forison in the opening hand, but I don't think so it's worth to keep it for TCG. For Korn Echo, though, with the Arcane Intellect, seems like a great keep.
It could be beneficial. So the key to this matchup, especially if both of these players are running the Forgotten Torch version, which does not run Healbot and does not run Archmage Antonitis. So what that means is that I talked earlier about how the win condition for that deck is not linear. But in this matchup, it is. It's basically the first player to acquire enough burn and play Alexstrasza wins the game. So you want to draw as much as possible. And Emperor Thorsand could allow you to play Alexstrasza one turn sooner, which could mean the difference in the game. So, you know, it's not quite as simple as that because, you know, if neither player draws enough burn and both players draw Alexstrasza, there's some, you know, nuances that make the matchup different. But I feel like that's just what it comes down to.
Or one of the players doesn't draw the ice block.
Yeah, that's true.
Or Matt Sand to get it, right?
Yeah.
So might be quite different. Wait, that's a novice engineer. Does it mean that he might be playing Reno Jackson?
It's possible, but the laughing list that I talked about earlier that the deck was based off of runs novice engineer as the draw.
Mm-hmm. Instead of the loot hoarders, so you have better access to a burn, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And there's Alexstrasza.
Oh, wow. That's going to be big.
And Korn Echo's on the coin. So that means that he can guarantee that he's the one who plays is Alexstrasza first. So the name of the game here for Korn Echo is just to, you know, acquire enough burn damage to get through the ice block and kill his opponent. So basically that's just 15 damage as long as you can pop the block at 1.
Yep. So now let's assume he will play Novice Engineer. He will still be at 7 cards, including the coin. And then he will draw next one on the beginning of the next turn, which puts him at 8 cards. And then he can change Arcane Intellect for additional 2, so it will be a 9, so it's still fine.
Yeah.
But he wants to play the Arcane Intellect before the Emperor, right? So I'm... So he didn't want to play a Novice Engineer here, so he wants to play it on turn 4 with the ping then.
Yeah. Maybe that makes some sense. You know, just playing on his turns. Doomsayer is sort of a dead card.
And it's not. It's really not. That's what I wanted to say now, that you probably want to save the Doomsayers right before turn 5, sorry, before turn 6, or before turn 9, because then you play around the Alexstrasza's and the Emperor's.
Yeah.
So this is why you would usually want to keep the Emperor, sorry, the Doomsayer for that occasion.
Ooh. So TCG does run Archmage Antonidas, but that doesn't change this matchup too much.
Mm-hmm.
It allows you to get more burn, but as long as you just have enough, that's really all you need, because neither of these lists, I'm going to guess, run an anti-heal bot, just because you have to make room for those Forgotten Torches somehow, and usually heal bot's one of the first cards to go.
It's really interesting when you think about it. Like, you put a Forgotten Torch, which acts as a removal for a 3, maybe 4 attack minion, and that gives you a heal for exactly that, right? Because the minion would usually just attack once with it, right? So basically achieves the same, achieves the same as a Farseer, but it doesn't put a body, but it puts a burn card in your deck.
Yeah,
it's really interesting.
It puts a Farseer that attacked twice in your deck.
Yeah, and it's a spell.
Yeah, and it's a spell. All right, well, assembling the pieces here for Koroneko. Mad Scientist is also a card that's going to be that could be pretty good. Mad Scientist is effectively cycle, as long as you haven't drawn into your secrets so far.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it pulls the card from your deck already, which means your quality of draw
increases.
Increases, yeah.
And you save 3 mana.
Yeah, that's true.
That's like the biggest plus, apart from the fact that you are basically playing a smaller deck than you should be.
Yeah.
Pink to the face and Doomsayer. That's interesting because Koroneko now should know that there's no Alexstrasza in his opponent's hand. And now if he keeps track of which cards are being drawn and played, he can make a guess, an estimated guess, if his opponent will have the Alexstrasza on turn 9.
Yeah. Well, Koroneko is at 10 cards at the moment, so he's got to play something. He can just play the second Doomsayer into this one.
Well, that's the that's exactly what happens with the Doomsayer, right? He prevents the Emperor on turn 6.
Yeah.
I mean, on turn 5, because there's the coin, right? But I think that Koroneko should just be... should just play his Mad Scientist pink, and that's it.
Yeah.
Again. He already has 2 Ice Lances.
Yeah. And Frostbolt.
Yep.
So as soon as that Alexstrasza comes down, Koroneko's going to find himself in a fantastic position. And no reason not to ping phase here, so... go ahead and do that. Oh, hello.
Well, that's a huge draw.
Yeah, that's actually a really big deal, because at this point, TCG might not even need Alexstrasza, because he's going to reduce not only Archmage Antonidas, but Frostbolt, Ice Lance, Forgotten Torch. He's going to have so many cheap spells in his hand that are not only burned in and of themselves, but can also be turned into more burn.
Well, he can play Antonidas, Frostbolt, Ice Lance next turn.
Yeah.
And get 2 fireballs.
Yeah.
That's just crazy.
And Archmage Antonidas isn't just that engine. It's also a threat that has to be dealt with.
Yep. And look at that. Koroneko has 2 Frostballs, 2 Ice Lances, and a Fireball. But the Fireball needs to be played on that Emperor, I think. I'm not sure. But I think it should be played on the Emperor right now.
Yeah.
You can't really let that, you know, just roam on the battlefield. Deal 5 damage.
Roam on the battlefield. Yeah, that's a good point. So... eloquently put. I like that.
Yes, that's a nice Doomsayer. It prevents the Antonidas and prevents prevents Antonidas. Basically, that's it.
Yeah.
But it's enough.
Yeah. You know, I like this these sort of... I don't want to call them mind games. They're not really mind games. They're just the players making really strong reads based on their opponent's plays. Like TCG's Doomsayer in the last turn. And Koroneko's Doomsayer this turn. You could argue that they don't have anything else to do with their mana, but, you know, these plays are calculated. Doomsayer does have value in this matchup, even though it's not as much as other matchups. TCG can play Archmage Antonidas and actually kill it.
I just wanted to say that you should play the Antonidas here anyway, because you kill the Doomsayer, you put a huge threat on the board, and you still have 3 fireballs.
Yeah. But he really values that.
Maybe it wasn't a mistake. Not sure. Because you basically give your opponent a advantage to play his own big minion, right? And it felt like, yeah, that's the moment where you're on a back foot for TCG. So it was maybe very important to play the Antonidas just to push your opponent to have an answer to it rather than build his own board. Because in this situation, the one mana that was gained by TCG doesn't change anything.
Yeah.
And if he wants to kill the Emperor, he would have to spend two burn cards anyway. So now Doomsayer and Mad Scientist in pink. Doomsayer and just Mad Scientist. I don't know if you even want to play the Mad Scientist right now. You don't want to draw ice berries though. So maybe you actually want to put it on board.
Huh. Surprised he didn't just Archmage Antonidas again. He's really protective.
Well, now it didn't make sense. Like, if he didn't play it last turn...
Then he's not going to play it this turn.
Yeah, he will wait two more turns to get the mana for the Roaring Torch or for the Frost Nova to get just three fireballs instead of two, right? So it made sense that he didn't play it this turn.
Yeah. So, even though you're playing this into a Doomsayer, you still just need to get it out. And, you know, that's a good read by TCG to realize that that it came out. And at this matchup, you're sort of hard looking for Alexstrasza. He knew that it was going to come out, and he was just trying to stop the body in his track. So another reason why playing Archmage Antonidas, not playing it last turn, was smart, because he finds a more efficient way to deal with the body of the Alexstrasza. Mm-hmm. But now TCG's in a lot of trouble, because he doesn't have the second ice block in hand. So he would have to find a way to pull it from the Mad Scientist. And his block, in his mind, he probably thinks that his block's going to be popped the next turn, which...
Is the case, of course.
Is the case, yeah.
But at the same time, TCG has to take, an opportunity to win the game.
Yeah.
And I think the opportunity is just Archmage Antonidas and just go straight to the dome with the burn cards.
Yeah.
Or play Mad Scientist and play the burn cards anyway, but then you don't have any more burn, right?
Yeah.
So that's a problem. So if you want to win the game, you need to play Archmage Antonidas and just burn your opponent, try to burn him as much as possible. And next in Mad Scientist, and probably you will use one of the fireballs to actually kill one of your Mad Scientists.
There was a secret pulled. If it's not...
For Koroniko?
Yeah. He played the Mad Scientist earlier. If it's not Ice Block, he just dies next turn.
Wow, Falnos.
Yeah. Actually, no. Regardless, unless he picks up an extra burn spell, he's not quite dead next turn, even if it is Ice Barrier. Because he would have to in order to push in, he would have to attack with Archmage Antonidas, which would in turn be a mistake. So he'd have to pick up a Frostbolt. So Koroniko can pop the block at one here with Frostbolt, Ice Lance, plus a ping. And he can actually do all that and Arcane Intellect and Mad Scientist.
Yeah, the Mad Scientist is crucial.
All right.
Well, is it? Because if your opponent can attack first... I'm not sure if you want to play the Scientist this turn. Because there's a chance that you will just get Ice Barrier, and that's not something you want.
Yeah. He's got to get these spells out of his hand.
Well, he needs to pop the block this turn, that's for sure.
Yeah. Hearthstone APM.
And? Was it correct? Did he miss one damage? Because of the Mad Scientist?
No, he got the ping off.
He got it, okay.
Yeah, because he used the ball's mana, so... he played that incredibly well, because now he still has... Frostbolt to play on the Mad Scientist. So he gets it all off. Very well played. And, judging by this Mad Scientist play, I think he did pull Ice Barrier from that. From that Mad Scientist earlier. Because playing the Mad Scientist with Ice Block already up, I think would have been...
probably a mistake, yes.
Yeah. Maybe not, though, because you know that your opponent's not really going to... Like, in order for TCG to put in maximum damage, he'd have to attack in with the Archmage Antonidas to test it anyway, so... Not quite sure. But it's a tough decision. So, but judging by that, I'd imagine that he pulled Ice Barrier.
Well, Distant has to be Mad Scientist,
Fireball,
Mad Scientist, and Ice Barrier. Ice Barrier first to get it. Otherwise, no, you actually have to go for the 50-50 because you need to deal 6 damage as well.
And he pulled Ice Barrier. He didn't play the Ice Barrier! Poor sequencing.
I mean, it's not really sequencing if you want to win the game, because you need to deal the damage, right?
Yeah. But
you won't have enough time.
But this didn't even guarantee...
Yes, but if he would guarantee the ice block, it would have been popped next turn anyway.
He could have drawn into defensive Alexstrasza, though. Like, he would have given himself an extra turn to draw into Alexstrasza. So, you know, that's the big thing here. And Koroneko's just going to be like, okay, well, I guess it was Ice Barrier after all. So TCG could have survived another turn, but, you know, I see what you mean there with probably inconsequential, and maybe even just fireballing the face after that would have been the right turn to play. But Koroneko takes game one.
Yeah, takes game one. Surprisingly, it was a fast game between the two Freeze Mages.
Freeze Mage has become a little bit quicker because they run less heals. They run, like, less stall.
Mm-hmm.
With the Forgotten Torches, there's more burn.
Yeah, there's no... you know, sometimes, like, let's say 1 year ago, the mirror matches of Freeze Mages were like, okay, I have two Blizzards in my hand, two Flame Strikes, two Frost Novas, and I have just to play them for no real effect.
Yeah.
So that was kind of disappointing for most of the games.
Nowadays, hands are just chock full of burn spells. And eventually, people are just going to start throwing them at the face. So we'll see what these guys decide to pick for their second decks. TCG still has all of his decks remaining, and Koroneko, just Druid and Warlock.
Secret Paladin versus Freeze Mage. And that's something that usually favors the mage. But, of course, there are exceptions, right?
Yeah.
If there will be a low tap that will seal the deal for one turn and just push the damage that he needs, or maybe a silence out of nowhere for an additional attack, the Doomsayer is key.
Yeah. Or even if you just have build a giant board early, then you can find wins in this matchup as well. Just Secret Paladin doing Secret Paladin things. Like you said, Doomsayer is key, but you also need something... Well, actually, in this matchup, you don't really need something to combo with the Doomsayer. A lot of times, you can just play it on, like, turn three and really just stop the momentum of the Secret Paladin in its tracks.
It's easy to calculate how much damage can your opponent deal, so you can just play the Doomsayer and be sure that your opponent will be one damage short to kill it. So that's one of the problems with Paladin, because against Zul... There are so many possibilities. Abuse of Surgeons, PO, just a silence, Die Wolf, many ways of buffing the attack.
Yeah. So, right now, Koroneko doesn't have the greatest of hands, but he does have a decent curve.
Shield Mini-Bot. That kind of surprises me, because he's giving up basically this card for pink and trade.
Does he have Noble Sacrifice up?
Does he?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
I don't know why I missed that.
Just can't. Yeah, we just can't see the secret on the
second
on the
Doomsayer.
Top there. Whoa! You can be a little bit liberal with your Doomsayers now.
Yeah, you can actually play it right now if you want to.
Throw these suckers out all willy nilly.
Do you want to play it right now?
Well, you're going into turn three. I mean, you just, like I said, stopping the momentum seems like it's pretty important.
It deals with the mini-bot. It stalls one turn, so you basically avoid a masterful battle, which is 3 damage. More importantly, the 3 mana masterful battle will not fit the next turns, like, at all.
Yeah.
So definitely a good call with the Doomsayer.
So one cool thing to note about the Vietnamese players that entered in this tournament, we played the preliminary rounds yesterday, and after the preliminary rounds, I believe there was 9 Vietnamese players who entered this tournament total. And after the preliminary rounds, 8 of them were still left.
I think you're correct, but let me check the
in
notes.
In the tournament, which is...
Vietnamese, yes, you're correct. 9 came down and 1 got eliminated.
Yeah, and that one was actually Neilio, which is kind of funny because he was the 2015
representative of CA at BlizzCon.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, that's a should be a testament to how strong the Vietnamese players, at least the ones that came here, are. If, you know, almost all of them made it through to the next round. So, been impressed with TCG's Lions so far. Had one potential slip up in the last game with a little bit of a sequencing. Korneko also. Korneko is one of the, you know, highest rated open players for North American tournaments. He's knocked me out of like 4 different opens.
Mm-hmm.
I've met him in the round of 8 of like Strivewire Cups many, many times.
Turn 3, 4 mage. Arcane Intellect is perfect.
Yes, it is. Not threatened on board. Definitely a solid turn. Feels like Korneko's already running out of steam.
Kinda, when you think about it.
Yeah.
The Doomsayer, like, one Frost Nova will just stop so much bleeding for TCG.
Yeah.
Just need to get that one Frost Nova. Ice Block? Well, not bad. I mean, you can play Mad Scientist, paying your opponent's mini bot, or just Frostbolt the Pilot Shredder if you want. I wouldn't mind actually Frostbolting the Pilot Shredder here.
It gives him a free trade with the mini bot, and it depends on what he wants to do next turn, I guess. Because next turn he can Forgotten Torch the Piloted Shredder,
mm-hmm.
depending on what comes down. And then still have Frostbolt to deal with maybe what comes out of it or, you know, another drop that he plays. So I understand his reasoning, but yeah, he is going to take more damage because of this line. So maybe taking out the Piloted Shredder would stop some of the damage that he would take.
But for Korneko, it doesn't look pretty. Like, he's running out of steam, as you said. He has no Mysterious Challenger, no Dr. Boom, and no Turian. Unless he will top deck all 3 of those.
Yeah.
In the upcoming turns. Like,
yeah.
Exactly, 6, 7, 8. Then it doesn't look pretty at all.
Stranger things have happened so far this tournament.
Where is the Cone of Cold when you need one? I still have nightmares about this card when it was for 3 mana.
3 mana.
It's disgusting.
Blizzard used to be 5 mana.
Blizzard was 5 mana. Frost Nova was 2 mana. Cone of Cold was 3 mana. Basically, that's it, if I remember
Pyroblast
correctly.
Pyroblast was...
And Pyroblast was 8 mana.
8 mana.
That was the best deck. Like, aggro mage
yeah.
with Cone of Cone as a, you know, as a time walk machine.
Yeah.
Because basically you stopped your opponent's board from attacking for 1 turn, you get a free attack with your mana vims, which were buffed.
And then you win on turn 8 with Pyroblast.
Or just turn 8 Pyroblast, turn 9 Pyroblast.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay.
Yeah. Alright, so, gonna have to use some of this burn here. But, you know, he knows that Korneko's out of stuff. We'll see where this Avenge pops. It's gonna go into the Shielded Minibot, but he does have a way to at least stop the bleeding here from the Shielded Minibot, so... He is going to Frostbolt it. He still has to deal with that, though.
Yeah, and there's no easy way to deal with it.
Yeah.
Unless he will get a Blizzard or a Frost Nova. Ooh, the Cockhammer. Well, unfortunately, didn't hit the 6-2, because I'm sure that he wanted to see the 6-2 with the Divine Shield instead.
Still okay.
4 damage is being pushed, plus the additional 2 from the weapon, which is actually very important. There's the Blizzard.
What did you say he could pick up there, Lothar?
Yeah, there's the Blizzard.
There is the Blizzard.
But is it the Blizzard better than the Emperor? Let's think about it. He's at 21. His opponent is out of cards, has 6 and 12, 13 damage. There's no way he will die next turn. If he drops the Emperor, his opponent will have to trade into the Emperor. That saves you at least 5 HP, because most likely it will be destroyed with the Pilot Shredder and Hunted Creeper, or weapon and Pilot Shredder, and the 6-2 minion will be still left on board, right?
Yeah.
So you soak a lot of damage, and you get your Antonidas with 0 mana Ice Lance, which will stop someone from attacking. And you get a 2-mana Ice Book, which is even more important. So, really like that.
Oh, the Repentance! Forgot about the Repentance.
Yeah, forgot about that.
Yeah.
But anyway, still a good play, I think.
Still a good play. Eventually, you're going to have to play something into that Repentance. Emperor Thorsan is probably the card that you'd want the most to be reduced to 1 health, because Doomsayer is usually an emergency card.
Yep, and you can't really put that in the range of any kind of attack.
Yeah. But look what's picked up for Corrin Echo. That is a Tyrion Forgering. So even if the board is removed, that can provide quite a bit of damage just by itself. And even the Ashbringer, you know, 15 damage over the course of 3 turns is pretty powerful against a Freeze Mage deck, especially if you can draw into a Lothab to block some turns or, like you said earlier, just chaining threats. Mysterious Challenger, Dr. Boom, Tyrion. Maybe he can do it in reverse order. Tyrion into Dr. Boom into Mysterious Challenger.
But still, that Repentance actually was really a big big deal for TCG, because it didn't save him the HP that I calculated after the attack.
Yeah.
So that's actually a really huge deal. If that would be Noble Sacrifice instead, it would be fine.
Yeah.
But with this additional 4 damage that he took, and the fact that he couldn't destroy the Divine Shield. Wow, did he just play that into Doomsayer?
Okay, it's on.
Well, that just happened.
Yeah, well, he's setting up Lethal next turn, regardless. He doesn't want to give the Freeze Mage any more time. So now the block is, not going to be popped because of the Ice Lance.
So. Yeah, and that puts Corrin Echo in a really awkward position. He can't play the Mass of a Battle, because then he destroys his weapon, which was played basically for 8 mana. Ooh. Well, but that's still not enough. There's a second Ice Block.
Yeah, and Fireball will still kill the Lothab. You know, it's going to be able to be played for 9 mana. So he can, you know, kill the Lothab with the Fireball, attack in with the Archmage Antonitis, and, you know, still he has the second Ice Block. The first Ice Block will be popped at like 4, but still, you know, that would be both Ice Blocks gone. Will he have enough time to end the game is the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because Corrin Echo is just 2 turns away from winning, because he is going to pop the block next turn regardless of what TCG does this turn.
Interesting play with the Tyrion. I think it was actually correct.
Yeah.
As weird as it sounds, but it's probably correct.
Yeah, it's all about Freeze Mage is all about buying one more turn.
Yeah.
A lot of time Freeze Mage wins games 1 turn before they were supposed to lose or were about to lose. So if you as the player playing against the Freeze Mage can find a play or a strategy that takes 1 turn, just 1 turn away from the Freeze Mage, then that could be the winning line. And you know, I like this play, TCG realizing that
his only way of winning is winning next turn, right?
Yeah, he just has to go face, and it looks like he is going to have enough damage. He has exactly 24 points of damage in his hand, and next turn he can do 12 of that and play the Ice Block. So I think he has found a way to win this game, unless Corrin Echo draws into a true Silver Champion next turn.
Never mind. Yeah, he has a Frostbolt.
Never mind. So Block's being played no matter what.
Now 12 damage to the face, and you have still 12 damage as you said, so that's more than enough. So I think, yeah, you should go for the face damage.
So Blood Mage, Thalnos, Frostbolt, Roaring Torch.
That's 4 and 7. That's 11 damage.
Makes it so that next turn, yeah, he'd be at 13. So next turn you could Frostbolt or Fireball Ping. So this plays around True Silver as being the only out.
Don't be shy.
Passionate Hearthstone fan.
I don't know why I ignored the fact that after Frostbolt you can't attack. So there's no way of popping the Ice Book then.
Yeah, absolutely no way.
Unless Consecration is played in that deck. Or Blessing of Kings.
Yeah, but even then he's still dead the next turn.
Okay, that kinda is different than I thought.
What?
So he'll kill the Falnos, that's for sure. When he still has 24 damage to the face next turn. And the ice block will not be popped this turn.
He only has 18 damage to the face next turn.
But he will not be dead.
He won't be dead. Yeah, I mean, I guess this play wins also. But he could have just won right now.
Yeah, of course, I agree. Yeah.
He basically just gave Koroneko an extra turn to find a way out. And I don't think there was a way out regardless, but still, I don't even know if I want to call that a risky play.
Well, what if Koroneko has a way to pop his own Pathless Shredder to get a healing totem and then have a True Silver Champion and attack? And that's 13 HP.
There you go. Bingo.
Well, it's still not enough, but...
Yeah.
Wow. That was a Frost Nova. Kind of too late, but never mind.
Yeah. But, you know, TCG finds a way to take the victory anyway, but he does not look happy about that win.
I think he is aware that something should have been done differently, and that turn with the ping for the 1-1, instead of just, as you said, playing the Roaring Torch to the face, was a kind of a big deal, right?
Yeah. Lothab would have been his only out, but he'd already played it.
Yes.
True Silver Champion couldn't be used because he had Frostbolted Face, which was the correct play to block that and to make it so he couldn't pop his block. But even if the block was popped, there wouldn't have been a way for Koroneko to win the game because TCG would have put him into lethal range. But very risky. Very risky play. And...
Imagine if there would be Kazan Mystic out of nowhere.
Yeah, for some reason, TCG, it seems like the safe play to him.
Yeah.
But it's actually the risky play, which is the funny thing. All right, here we go.
It's kind of true. By the way, once upon a time when I was playing ladder, I was playing with Eye for an Eye instead of the fifth secret, you know?
Yeah.
And it won me 3 games in a row against a freeze mage.
Yeah.
They always killed themselves.
Did you hear my cast earlier? I actually mentioned that exact situation. The
really?
Next level tech cards. I did, yeah.
Oh.
You were off,
that.
Though, so you were off resting. But, I actually mentioned that exact situation.
Interesting.
The fifth secret, everybody's always like, it's repentance.
Yeah.
Just default. Oh, it's repentance.
Against freeze mages is awesome.
Yeah. And nobody ever expects the old sacred trial also.
Yeah, but the sacred trial to pull it off, actually... That's so hard.
Yeah. It's almost impossible. It's like an even more situational mind control tech. And it doesn't even steal it. It takes it. Or it just kills it.
It just deals the damage. It's like a worse snipe.
Yeah. Like a worse snipe. Yeah, exactly.
Dark Peddler, what will you get us? Ooh, a Flame Imp.
Ooh, a Bloodsail Corsair. That's what I'm looking at.
Well, it buys some time. Because your opponent will have to re-dagger, and re-dagger is 2 mana, and 2 mana is a lot.
I think you just wait until your opponent attacks with a buff, waiting for a Blade Flurry.
That's usually my problem against rogues, because most of them are not doing that mistake.
Yeah.
They actually just attack the same turn that we will Blade Flurry. So that's the turn when they just go, you know, for the damage.
I'm still disappointed. Sure. Still disappointed.
Who doesn't want to see a oh my god. The Corsair.
Yeah.
On the board.
Yeah.
The agent doing work, as usual. This guy's backstab agent.
Yeah.
That doesn't change things.
I'm telling you, there's going to be a situation that's going to happen right now where he would have wished he had Bloodsail Corsair.
Probably.
He's going to dagger up and attack into the Voidwalker. And then there's going to be just a juicy 1 durability, 3 attack weapon that's just waiting to be
destroyed.
Plundered. I don't know. What is...
Ransack?
Ransacked? He's going to ransack his weapon.
Not sure if that's the correct context.
I don't know. I don't even know. It's a good question. English is my native language, and I don't even know.
Oh, he will not even attack. If only Harrison Jones would have been there. I mean, that's actually better for Koroniko. He plays around the Corsair, you know?
Yeah, but he could have taken one durability off. He could have replayed the Ink Gang boss and played the Blood Cell Corsair.
Funny stuff. Funny stuff.
Yeah.
So Implosion, just to drag out that Fan of Knives or Blood Blade Flurry.
Yeah.
From Koroniko. Because if you play the Belcher, just dies to PO, and that's such a, you know, easy scenario.
Yeah, it still just buys time. But Lothep is actually going to be... That's a big deal, because there's been a lot of creatures played already, and usually the creatures that... minions that Rogue plays are usually supplemented by spells, like by the Teacher.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
or even Azure Drake. Usually the spell power is used almost immediately a lot of the time. So playing Lothep going into a turn where, you know, you're sort of... You've just lost initiative, which he did. He has, you know, a smaller board compared to the Sludge Belcher that Koroniko has.
Yep.
Makes it so the Rogue's turn very awkward, and that can be the turn that you need to come back, but...
Agree. And I think this is the turn one, just play Lothep, especially that turn six will most likely include the Iron Beak Owl at something. And then turn seven is Dr. Boom. So you won't have time to play the Lothep until turn eight.
Yeah.
And if your opponent is running low on cards, he wants to use the sprint as well. And now you deny that.
Yeah. And it also opens up a bigger possibility that you'll be able to use Gormok the Impaler next turn, because you know that your opponent's probably going to spend all of their resources killing off this Lothep, which I think Koroniko's going to do, just to, you know, attack in with both of these. In the next turn, he'll be able to play the potentially Owl with Gormok.
Mm-hmm.
He's actually just going to go face.
Oh, my.
He's going to get really punished.
Oh, my. Owl, Gormok, face, and then deal 8 damage to the face, or trade with the Lothep?
I don't even know if he needs the Owl. Yeah, that's a lot better. Pushing the face damage is important. I was thinking about the value game, being able to fit in a tap, but still being able to clear the Belcher, but this puts in a lot of work. Like you said, just getting that face damage in, really important in the long run of this game.
Now, Koroniko is in a really bad spot, because he has no way of dealing that additional 1 damage. If only he would have a Fan of Knives right now, he would be able to kill the Gormok, I mean, get additional 5 damage from the Lothep, but it's not really that important if you kill the whole board, right?
Yeah.
Seems like a turn for preparation sprint.
Try and pick up some additional tools.
Oh, just that.
Yeah. Whoa, this is actually a lot of damage.
That's actually 12.
It's gonna be 12 damage to the face. Next turn, he can pick up some stuff with prep sprint, and maybe
double PO.
Find a way.
Wow, that's actually huge.
Yeah. Still, Dr. Boom, best thing that can happen on turn 7 on an empty board.
Especially against the Rogue. Rogue has probably the toughest time dealing with Dr. Boom, because usually how they deal with it is sap.
Yes.
And that just means that you're giving your opponent more boom bots.
The problem is that even, like, the sap is correct play here. And the problem for TCG is that he is only on 12 HP.
Hmm.
So if his Dr. Boom is getting sapped, he probably won't replay it, because he wants to put something on board that will defend his hero. So most likely the Defender of Argus will have to be played. So the tempo play will actually matter a lot here.
He's waiting as long as possible to play the prep sprint. And a lot of times that's correct, just because you never know if you're going to find something to play with prep sprint.
Well, it might be not even prep sprint, might be just prep eviscerate or something like that. Well, that's insanely good with the Defend of Argus.
Yeah.
So, Bran? No. I don't like that.
This play is still good. This puts a lot of boombots on the board. Boombots are very scary. And that does 4.
4 damage.
This is basically lethal next turn. Alright, well, we'll see what he can pick up. So, do you play the Violet Teacher before you prep sprint to try and reduce the chance that these boombots are going to go face if they attack into something? Or do you just not play any minions and make it so that the boombots have to just attack face by themselves anyway?
I think the Violet Teacher in the sprint is probably better because you still have a chance of getting backstabs and another prep into something.
Ooh.
And you don't want to play the Fan of Knives into this empty board anyway, because that's like a death sentence.
So if he if he plays Fan of Knives,
he dies.
Yeah. Well, the Boombots, to him, maybe not. Because the Boombots would have to do 9 damage total. They'd have to average 3, which is above average for just him to clear on the board. But that would not account for if he had an Abusive Sergeant or a Defender of Argus or a Power Overwhelming, and he has actually 2 of those. So
that's 10-14 damage with the bomb, with the PO, and the Defender of Argus will add the additional 2 damage. So the bomb explosion is not even needed in the first place.
He could have even brand and then Defender of Argus for an extra 2 damage. So, lethal by far, TCG had there. So that's going to be him taking a 2-1 lead in the series over Koroneko. Going into a, I'd say it's an unfavored matchup. I think Oil Rogue's definitely a good deck against Zoo Warlock.
Yeah, it's not the worst one, I would say.
Yeah.
Especially when you have a start with Backs of Agent.
Yeah.
It's like a really powerful start. And even with that, he wasn't able to clear to win the game. I'm still thinking about the turn when he made the Oil Blade Flurry turn. Maybe that was the turn when should have been played differently.
Yeah, he could have prep sprint that turn, which would have taken a lot of damage.
But he could have played prep sprint into sap, I think.
Yeah, but he would have had to sap a Lothep, because there was a Lothep on the board.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. But he gave up all of his resources, and he also gave up initiative to clear the board, which, you know, I like, but maybe didn't work out for him in the long run. But we'll have to see. He is down now. Keep in mind, this is a lower bracket match.
And this is insane. Emperor on turn 4, on Dr. Boom. He just needs another minion. Wanted to say it in his hand. He can still top deck a Lothep, a Druid of the Claw, a Belcher, a Pirate Shredder, a Shade of Naxxramas. So 5 different minions that can be played next turn. And then after that, you have Dr. Boom.
Yeah. Or yeah, he could wait one more turn, innervate out Dr. Boom next turn, and then play Emperor Thor's Hand behind it.
But don't you want to put a minion on board right now and make this swipe 3 mana? So you can swipe and hero power next turn if needed. Because if your opponent, if you play the Emperor, you're baiting out a Masterful Battle, most likely.
Yeah.
And if that happens, then you have the swipe. You definitely don't want to swipe here, because if your opponent sees a swipe, then he's like, okay, clear. I can play my Masterful Battle.
Yeah.
And now I have huge value from the Masterful Battle.
Yeah, he could Savage Roar here just to remove the Knife Juggler. But
I don't like that as well.
Yeah. All right, so basically he's putting his eggs into the basket of I need a turn 5 play.
But he has a lot of outs for the turn 5, so it should be fine in theory.
In theory.
There's the Master Battle. One hit. Second hit. And the third hit. What? Well, that was nice.
Yeah.
Now he can just play Coin, Noble Sacrifice, and ignore it, but that would be a mistake in the hindsight, because then swipe and hero power plays around it.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I like this play, coining out the competitive spirit. That sort of forces TCG into a position where he feels like he needs to swipe. Ooh, and if he plays Druid of the Claw, he won't be punished necessarily, just because the Muster for Battle tokens would still have to trade up into the Druid of the Claw, so...
Well, it's Muster for Battle and Competitive Spirit, right? So it's, like, practically a card and a half.
Yeah.
Because there's still, like... Okay, let's not count Lights of Justice as a half of a card. It's, like, quarter of a card. So...
Maybe not even a fifth of a card.
Especially in this matchup. So... Yeah. Not really that important. So it's not that bad. But I wouldn't blame him for just using Swipe this turn. Because as the game progresses, the swipe has less impact.
Yeah.
Especially for free mana.
Oh, well, I like this play. He's going to test for Avenge first to try and get it out of the way since he knows he's going to be swiping anyway. Now he might just hold on to this. Now you're kind of in the well, I'm going to swipe. Because it's either... No, it's not Redemption. It could be Repentance.
Probably not Repentance. Well, he won't know now. But the problem would be that a 2-2 minion, two of them actually, are not easy to remove from that point, right?
Yeah.
You would need a second swipe, or a Rav and a hero power, something along those lines to make your life easier, right? And that's a huge problem.
Yeah.
Let's go, Dr. Boom.
Dr. Boom!
Stun 6. Go for it, bro.
Yeah, and this hand from Koronek is just not that good. He's got both of his noble sacrifices. He doesn't have any of his big bombs, and you can see Koroneko, he's very disheartened by that play, to say the least.
Yeah.
Picks up a mysterious challenger, but he's used so many of his secrets already.
Competitive spirit gone. Two noble sacrifices in hand. What else? That's about it.
I feel like there was one more secret played early on, but maybe I'm
No,
no,
Repentance is still in the deck, and yeah. Avenge is still in the deck.
Yeah.
That's basically it.
Yeah, so he's going to have to decide here. There's no way outside of just Consecration for him to deal with the Dr. Boom here. And if he uses Consecration, he's really not developing anything else. But I think that's his only choice. I don't think he can afford to leave the Boom up for another turn. He can just hope that the shooter minibot stays alive to contest what's left on the board.
Oh my, that's a huge deal. If that minibot would actually been alive, that would change the dynamic of the whole matchup right now.
Yeah.
So Noble Sacrifice is being played, and now what I would like to see is Hero Power, check for Noble Sacrifice, and then if it's Noble Sacrifice, you go Drift the Claw Charge.
Yeah.
Deal 4 damage to the face. Because the opponent is at 19 now, you have the Savage Roar already in hand, so you know that you just need Force of Nature next turn and you just win. You have 2 outs to draw.
It sounds so easy, but those Force of Natures could be so far away.
Yeah, they can be far away, but at the same time, Druid of the Claw already does the damage, and that will stack up really fast.
Yeah.
I mean, what's the point of playing Druid of the Claw in taunt mode against the Paladin with no board? Where shall I strike? I'm just, you know, thinking out loud. But I don't see a point, right? Because even if there's Truce of a Champion, your minion will deal 6 damage, including the heal.
Yeah.
Right? So, that's a lot.
He's just feeling his deck right now. He's just trying to feel where those Force of Natures are. And by putting it in top mode, he's thinking that his Force of Natures are pretty far away.
Oh, my God.
Hello!
Actually, when I think about it, with the Living Roots being played on board, the taunt mode makes really a lot of sense. So, kudos to him. That was better played than what I suggested with the charge.
Yeah. That's just...
But that Big Game Hunter, that is just disgusting.
Incredible draw. Incredible.
No! Repentance dealt 1 damage. That's basically game when you think about it.
Yeah. That mysterious challenger was sort of Koroneko's last hope.
I was thinking maybe you should just use the Savage Roar this turn before attacking with those 2 small minions. That's actually 8 damage for 2 mana.
Yeah, but you're most likely going to have creatures on the board next turn regardless, just because Consecration's been used. Usually Consecration is a 1-of, and he's actually, I like this, not trading, keeping that 1-1 alive because he knows that
That has to be the play.
Did somebody say swing turns? These need to hit these 1-1s. Face is not the place, juggler.
One.
Oh! Oh, man. That's, unfortunate.
That's rough.
Still gets 1 more juggle, but this he's... Okay. So he sacrificed the noble... Sacrificed the noble sacrifice to make sure that he got 1 more juggle off.
So 6 damage from Savage Roar. That's unfortunately not enough.
Yeah, and this board is actually pretty menacing. You kind of want to trade in this knife juggler here. I don't think you can afford to go face, but he might feel like he needs to. He needs to put him at 14 to make it out.
Yeah, probably correct. The problem will be that the Belcher will actually be a huge roadblock.
19 cards left, so still a lot. Combo could still be far away. Does have a cycle next turn with Wild Growth, and that would still allow him to use combo. And he's most likely going to have a creature left on the board if he draws it. It's just, will he be able to get through Sludge Belcher? Tyrion!
Oh my.
This game is delivering.
Those draws. It's rather ridiculous when you think about it.
Yeah, the thing is, with at this stage in the game, in this matchup, the Druid has a very defined win condition. With just drawing combo and piecing together enough minions on board to make the combo lethal. The Paladin has a lot harder time because they don't have that sort of pocket win condition. They just have to piece together enough damage with just minions alone, which is a lot harder to do. So in these types of situations, the Druid has such a bigger advantage. Just because even though their creatures overall could potentially be weaker, if the Paladin drops bombs like Tyrion, they just have so much better of a win condition in the long run.
That's correct, and I'm thinking now, trying to calculate the odds, and I think Druid of the Claw, Charge, Savage Roar is the best possible action. You sacrifice the Paladin Shredder to kill the Tyrion because you use your face to just destroy the Divine Shield, and then you deal 6 damage to your opponent's face, and you put him at 11.
But then you're giving up your Savage Roar, so then you have to draw both pieces to finish the game, which gives your opponent so much more time.
Well, I would have just used the Savage Roar for 8 damage. Like the turn when he had the access to it.
True.
And that would be like, you know, a huge swing.
All right, well, these are some really great cards that Koroniko's ripping off the top here. And this is going to be so much damage. He's actually applying a lot of pressure. So TCG now all of a sudden is on a clock. And Koroniko also has Belcher to block even more damage.
And the Noble Sacrifice.
Oh!
Well, okay. So now there has to be a guess made by TCG. Is that a Noble Sacrifice or is that an Avenge?
Oh, man.
Because those are the only secrets left. So it's 50-50.
What about Redemption? Has Redemption been played?
I think. But it should be. Yeah, it was pulled by the Mysterious Challenger.
Oh, yeah, that's true. That's right.
I'm actually thinking that the Keeper with damage is the option here. Your opponent won't kill you this turn, and you deal additional 4 damage, and you play the Shade of Naxxramas and just deal face damage. Yeah. And he's actually doing it. I really like that a lot.
This is going to be very close. So with the Shade of Naxxramas and just the Paladin Shredder, he'd be at 13. 7 plus 6. That'd be exactly 13 next turn with the Shade and the Paladin Shredder and just Savage Roar.
Mm-hmm.
Whoa, no!
And that might hurt him.
So he played around. He didn't even play around Blessing of Kings because Blessing of Kings kills him anyway.
Yes, exactly. So I don't know what he was playing around.
So I don't think there's a single card there that killing off the 1/1 affects at all, because Keeper of Ultimate would have only been 13.
Yep, I agree. I agree completely.
Now the Belcher makes it so that the Savage Roar damage would have been blocked, but he set himself. He had a perfect opportunity to set himself up. For what?
Where's the dragon that spawns your opponent
Hungry
at 1 minute?
Dragon.
Hungry dragon. Well, I guess you need to use the Savage Roar this turn.
Yeah, just to start clearing off the board a little bit.
I mean, you're dead to the weapon next turn anyway.
You need a taunt,
you need
maybe?
A taunt, yes. That's not a taunt.
Wow. What a game that was!
Oh, it was close.
Yeah.
That was really close. So if he would have attacked the face, would have set up 13, right?
Yeah.
On Koroniko, and then he would have been able to push with two minions. So that's basically 5, 7, 9 damage.
Yeah.
He would have been 4 off.
He would have been 4 off, but, you know, from his perspective, without Belcher considered, no noble sacrifices left. He had an opportunity to, from his perspective, to set up lethal, and he didn't take it. He decided to trade into the 1-1 instead, which I don't think there's many worlds where that's the correct play. He's just not playing around much of anything. He's just trading because he's scared.
Yeah, that's true.
Which is not what you need to do. You need to make your decisions calculated and not play by feel. And he did not do that, but
he would actually set up lethal also for a swipe top deck.
Yeah. Yeah, very true. So now we're moving into game number 5. Koroneko with the Rogue and TCG with the Druid. He does have an Innervate early on. But if he goes with this play, he has no plays for a long time.
Well, he wants to play the Wrath, so I don't know exactly, but it's kind of weird to see that. Because I'm sure that Koroneko will just backstab and attack with the dagger.
Yeah. And now TCG is just sort of resigned to hero powering for between 1 and 3 turns.
Yep.
At least. Unless he picks up a...
That's not it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that coin interface might have been a really huge mistake.
Yeah. Is there any world where he wraths for 1 on his ship's cannon?
No, you need that wrath for the 3-3 minions, yeah, or for the Path of Shadow.
Yeah. TCG is still pushing a lot of damage, though. That's one thing that the innervated Pilot of Shredder does, is 4 attack is quite a bit to have to deal with on turn 2.
That's nice.
Yeah.
That's very nice. But now the Wrath will come in handy.
But then the Pilot of Shredder comes down, and TCG still has no play for turn 4.
Yep.
Unless he picks up a Pilot of Shredder. Unless he picks up a... another
Sanjin?
Wrath? a Sanjin Shieldmaster?
I mean, someone was playing Sanjin today. Can't remember who, but someone was playing that. And now TCG is on the back foot. And
Nothing. That's
not a 4 drop.
Nothing.
Well, that looks awful.
Yeah.
Hero power and attack to the face. Pass.
Yeah. So that means that Koroneko is going to have complete initiative with 2 minions on board, which as a rogue is devastating. And spell power. Lothep could do some work, but you know, there's you could trade in with the Pile of Shredder, attack with the weapon, Earthwing Farseer your face to heal yourself back up and make up for some of that deficit. But this is not where you want to be if you're TCG. That was a good poem.
Well, you need to play the Lothep. Astral Drake just doesn't cut it.
Yep.
And doesn't make a difference. Wow.
That is
brutal.
That's probably the best draw on his deck, because this allows him to develop 2 minions on a turn where Lothep's played, fill up all of his mana. He doesn't get to re-dagger, but he clears off the Lothep and is left with Azure Drake, whatever comes out with the Shredder, and those two minions. So
you have to trade with the Shredder. That's for sure. And you need to play around Mana Wrath, so you need to play the minions first.
Yep. Very true. Mana Wraith, and also, since SI Agent is a battle cry. Oh no, it's a combo. Just kidding. I forgot what I said.
Yeah. But look at that. The Falnos.
Yeah.
That's even more incredible, because now it pushes TCG to use the swipe. Like, you need to use the swipe.
He can swipe Wrath, but he's still not developing anything. He's giving initiative over to Koroneko once again. He's going to cycle through one of his cards. So he's going to be drawing 2 cards, and he's still going to be left with a creature on board. So I think it's a must-do.
Yeah, that doesn't change anything. Still 1 minion left.
Yeah.
2 draws for Koroneko. And he has a minion on board, as you said, which is very important against druids in general.
Yeah.
Ooh, that's a minion. It doesn't really matter if he has a battle cry or not. It's just a huge minion.
Yeah.
And that's what matters.
And also, he's got a huge minion. He knows that he's guaranteed to have a creature on the board the next turn. And Deadly Poison, Tinker, Sharpsoil as well.
Yeah.
So, Koroneko is a
5/8
Blade Flurry top deck away from killing.
Well, Eviscerate does it as well, right? This is 6, 8, 9, 14, 17. Yes, Eviscerate or Blade Flurry wins the game.
Yeah.
Instantly. Yeah. Unless your opponent has a taunt or a heal.
Yeah.
And we see that TCG doesn't have that option.
Yeah.
So he will just use Ancient of Law to draw two cards. Or just play Dr. Boom.
Or just play Dr. Boom, yeah.
Yeah, probably Dr. Boom is better. And then just Kuroneko top decks a Eviscerate and or Blade Flurry, and it's GG.
He's got both Eviscerates and both Blade Flurries still left in his deck, so with 18 cards, four of those being out, it's, like a 20% chance-ish.
And?
What is it?
Aww.
Tinkers.
That's not it.
That's 18 damage?
It's 18, yes.
Yeah. If he plays both Tinkers. And you oh, man. This is a tough situation.
You get combo from one, right?
You only get combo from one, so yeah.
So it's 3, and then 6, 9, 14, 17, 18, yes.
Exactly 18. And this is one of the reasons why Dr. Boom is such a strong card, because these Boom Bots can kill this board, which is, Kuroneko worked really hard to make this board. And now he's... Is he just going to go for it?
Wait. Well, he has to use the Fan of Knives after he trades. He uses the 6-2 to trade with Dr. Boom.
I think you trade this into the Dr. Boom. You might as well take the opportunity to get this this trade in. And hopefully these Boom Bots don't deal too much damage. There's the Blade Flurry as the next card!
Next turn. Well, now he's still off.
Well, the thing is, Kuroneko actually attacked. Oh, I guess it doesn't matter.
Yeah, it didn't matter, but look at that. He still has 6 attack with the weapon. And then he has the Tinkers for the second attack. For actually, you just Blaze Flurry and then make the second weapon and oil.
Yeah.
No difference.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, which is 8 total mana, so we would have enough. So really, the only way for TCG to survive here is Ancient of Lore heal.
Is that enough? Because that's 14. I mean, it is enough, but will that set up lethal for next turn? It won't. Because you have combo for 14 and 7, so it's 21.
It's going to die anyway. I'd imagine that Kuroneko is just going to go ahead and Blade Flurry, because he can even sprint in Blade Flurry.
Yeah, that's true. Oh, look at that. How much damage is that?
He doesn't have enough mana.
Correct. One.
If he had held on to his weapon last turn and not attacked face, he could just oil Blade Flurry and Eviscerate. So the attack to face... Last turn was... Actually, no, because it would have made the dagger 9 attack, so he'd actually still be one off lethal, even with that.
Yeah, you're correct.
Yeah, so this is like more efficient, I guess, because
this way
you actually fit in one more damage.
He would fit more damage because you would have one more attack with not 6, but with 8.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, would have been exact.
With 9, sorry. So it would have been enough.
Yeah, I'm confusing myself. All right, well, I can imagine this is just going to be a Blade Flurry turn, and then next turn he can try and set up another lethal, but can he find a way to finish the game is the thing.
Well, he has the access to oil. Wait, but he's dead next turn, right? Oil plus 3 and Eviscerate, that's 8 damage exactly. So he needs to armor up this turn. With the hero power.
Yeah, well, I think that's... Yeah, just armor up, so... Oh, that's still lethal. Because he can Azure Drake, prep oil, and then eviscerate. So that'd be exactly...
But he doesn't
damage.
Have a dagger.
Oh, he doesn't have a dagger. Oh, no, it's still enough, because that's exactly 10 mana. Azure Drake,
oh, yeah, right,
dagger
correct.
Up,
yeah,
prep
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oil, eviscerate is exactly 10 mana.
You're correct. It's a long day.
And it'd be exactly 9 damage... And it looks like Kuroneko is going to spot it. Yes, he is.
Eviscerate for 5. Redagger.
Prep oil. And that means Kuroneko, with the fist bump, is going to take the series. Gives a little wave to the camera as well. What an impressive comeback from Kuroneko.
Well, That match was hectic.
Yeah, very hectic. Yep, there he is. Look at him, so happy in his chair. Yeah. So big congratulations to Koroneko. He'll be moving on to fight another day in the Singapore Major. And unfortunately, that means I believe TCG is eliminated since that was a lower bracket match.
I believe so. So we'll not see him tomorrow, but tomorrow we'll have the top 8 winners bracket and top 8 losers bracket, right?
Yeah, well, tomorrow we're gonna finish it all, Lothar. Tomorrow we will crown the Singapore Major champion.
The first one, actually.
The first one, yeah. Hopefully many more. It's been a fun trip here to Singapore. I love the Southeast Asian crowd. Had a chance to come here last year as well, or at least to the Philippines.
The crowd is amazing. You're right.
Yeah.
The weather is not so much, but
yeah, it's very hot. If you like hot and humidity, then you'll like it. But once again, that was a really fun match, a good match to sort of end the day.
It definitely had it all. Yeah. Like the emotions, you know, proper playing, and just everything that Hearthstone needs.
Yeah.
Some RNG as well.
Yeah. Well, Lothar, what were your thoughts on the day so far? Because that was the last match of the day. What were your thoughts on your overall thoughts on the Hearthstone matches that we saw today?
I'm kind of disappointed I didn't see more weird decks.
Yeah.
I thought like when I come here, and I will see all those, you know, aggro mages with ice blocks or some other really weird non-European, non-American style of decks. But it seems like Hearthstone is at the end of the metagame before the expansion, and everyone is kind of, you know, just like, I have this figured out, so I'm just playing this and that.
Yeah.
So
we did see Sir Finley and some Secret Paladins, which is a little bit of interesting tech. We saw Murloc Paladin lose a whole heck of a lot.
6, actually, games.
Yeah. And winning 0. So that was an impressive performance in the opposite direction for Murloc Paladin. But it's been a fun day, but that is going to do it from us here at the Singapore Major, the Southeast Asia, the Asia-Pacific Singapore Major. So we will return tomorrow, same time, same place, for the conclusion of the Singapore Major. So thank you guys for watching, and we'll see you all tomorrow.